I'm beginning to wonder if he actually works here at this point, or if he is just a customer that likes wearing blue vests.
Huge operation, bulldozers, earth movers, digging up our lawn, drilling through cinder block downstairs. I had to wear a hard hat just to use my restroom, which still doesn't make sense to me.
Don't pull up to the Arby's window and ask if they have
Oh my
cappuccinos.
God. Green Goblin like stops and comments, "Wow, these are really good. You can taste the nutmeg." He lowers his weapon and he's like, "You know, maybe you're right. I didn't ask for all this. I've always been a song and dance man by trade."
This is the Snaggletooth Rock and Roll Podcast.
I'm living far away where anything can reach the ceiling.
So, interesting week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I found out this week? You have to be careful if you wear a pair of jeans with stars on the butt.
Oh, yeah.
Because if you're dealing with the public, inevitably, apparently, someone will ask you, how many people smacked you in the butt today?
Who says that to a
Like,
stranger?
no one. To which she said, well, I bet you're hoping I won't be the first. I'm like, you would be correct again. What a weirdo.
By the way, this week's sponsor is Reptilian Fetish Soda. Interesting. I heard that the anaconda don't want none unless it's got fun.
Maybe buns with stars. Gotta have those star-spangled buns.
Absolutely. Okay. So my daughter put on the old, remember the old Spider-Mans with Tobey Maguire? They're like 20 years old now.
God. Makes me feel old.
Yeah, and I haven't watched them in years, right? But I was kind of half paying attention to it. And the woman that plays Aunt May is a fascinating character. She's like an old English actress. She's like this skeleton of a woman, this lonely widower, like a bit player in the show. She acts sort of as like Peter Parker's moral compass
Yeah.
once in a while and bakes things, right? And interestingly, she often gets into situations where she's like at a party with the villains or something, where it gets captured by the villains. The thing that she's so disarming. It's like, never mind the fact that the Green Goblin's this heavily armed, 8 foot tall, cackling homicidal maniac. She talks to everyone like they're her grandkids. Why, don't be ridiculous. Who would want to blow up this building? Foolishness, if you ask me. I think what you need is to try one of my signature snickerdoodles. This batch just came out of the oven. And the funny part is, she gets to them. Like, it actually starts to work. Green Goblin, like, stops and comments, "Wow, these are really good. You can taste the nutmeg." He lowers his weapon and he's like, "You know, maybe you're right. I didn't ask for all this. I've always been a song and dance man by trade." But then something blows up and like snaps him back to kill Spidey Moon. But if they just gave her a little more time, I think she could talk these men out of a life of crime, you know?
Yeah, you know what? She never gets credit for the little pep talks in the films.
Right.
You know, she could have diffused any problem. You know, unfortunately, she usually gets interrupted, but
Right,
she could
right.
have. You know, some horrifying villain like Venom has a bunch of hostages tied up. He's giving a speech about world domination, but Aunt May addresses the situation. Ruling the world? Fiddlesticks. You look cold, dear. Here, I knitted you this shawl. Just drape it over your shoulders. It's like a hug you can wear.
And Venom's like, "Wow, you knitted this by hand? Interesting use of the herringbone lace stitch. This material's so soft I could die. Was it like a pattern or?" And then boom, there's an explosion, you know. Again, so the bottom line is, forget Spider-Man. Lock these villains in a room with her for 10 minutes, no matter how deranged they are. They'll come out wanting to help old ladies across the street and knit sweaters for homeless kittens.
It's like therapy.
Yep, she's like the ultimate therapist, yeah. So, and now we move on to Mark and Stacey's unpublished commandments of drive-through window etiquette.
Write these down.
Here we go.
Read the menu before pulling up to order. Do not start by asking for things they don't have. For instance, don't pull up to the Arby's window and ask if they have
Oh my
cappuccinos.
God.
Similarly, do not ask dumb questions like, what exactly are the spices in the Chick-fil-A sauce? May I try a souffle cup sample or some grape poupon? It doesn't matter if the answer is toxic waste. It's damn tasty.
That's all you need to know. Don't try to negotiate specific Pokemon characters for your kid's Happy Meal at the drive-thru. If you need to make more than one modification at the drive-thru window, it's not for you. Don't order a number three meal without cheese, fries, or a bun, and then ask if you can substitute crab cake for extra lettuce. Ain't gonna work.
If it's pouring down rain, be kind and please turn off your windshield wipers. The cashier doesn't need to be doused in rainwater and strobed splashed for $8 an hour.
Yeah.
Please pay with a credit card or paper cash, which would mean no change.
Yeah.
The rest of us are hungry, and we are not impressed at your fishing around for exact change under your seat, in your ashtray, and getting out and looking through the gym bag in your trunk. Nah, bad etiquette. Our feature interview this week is with the Scottish metal band Midas Fall. We have a lovely chat about the making of their stellar new record, Cold Waves Divide Us. They tell us about the origin of the band, winning Prog Magazine's Limelight Award, and how they came up for that crazy mushroom trip video for the title track to the new record. Stay tuned for that.
Okay, let's play a song. This is Midas Fall with I Am Wrong. Okay, let's talk about Patreon. The site is patreon.com/snaggletoothpodcast. And for $6.66 a month, you get a criminal amount of market space that can't get anywhere else.
This is special features we just do for our patrons. You won't find them here on the regular podcast episodes. We offer everything from bizarre music reviews to old vinyl lookbacks to my cooking tips.
To her workout tips.
And possibly some gardening tips I'll give you tomorrow.
Yep, yep.
I've been growing peppers from seed again.
Yep. She had a bunch of my seed earlier. Oh. Anyway, this week I'm going to be reviewing the ZZ Top album La Futura that they made with Rick Rubin. Interesting stuff. And I just finished doing a ranking of all the Death Angel records, which I'll also be putting up on Patreon. Which ones are must-haves? You just have to tune in and see. Okay. Let's talk about the Great Sunday Microwave Caper.
God. So, epic tale.
So as we've mentioned in the show before, all the gas lines in our street are being dug up and replaced, right? Well, last Friday was my day to be home to let the dude in five layers of reflective clothing that spoke three words of English and smelled like a B.O. casserole and to put him in, right? Huge operation, bulldozers, earth movers, digging up our lawn, drilling through cinder block downstairs. I had to wear a hard hat just to use my restroom, which still doesn't make sense to me. I'm a little confused there. But anyway, so it gets to be about lunchtime and I go to fire up the stove to cook up a steak. And I'm like, there's no gas, idiot, right? I thought about using the air fryer, but I feared some sort of Oppenheimer adjacent explosion if I dropped a frozen sirloin in there. I don't think it would do well, you know? So I'm still getting over my fear of the air fryer a little bit. So I pop in the microwave and I hit defrost and all of a sudden the microwave does its best David Lee Roth impersonation. Skiddly boppy bloopty bloop.
Literally, this is what it said on the display.
Yeah, it's done. It's fried as opposed to my steak, which is not even close to fried, right?
We tried just hitting the numbers we usually hit and pressing start.
It was so done, right? I think it was like 10 years old anyway. So of course I couldn't leave because Fernando Valenzuela is still mucking around in the basement, right? And so I finally got the microwave to thaw it out as its dying act, and it earned a brief memorial service. The end of an era. It's our time to mourn. The nachos, the macaroni, and the popcorn. Your one-touch function was the best, and now you've earned eternal rest. So long story short, they finished up, and then we went about the task of trying to replace the microwave, right? Taking out the ancient above range thing was pretty gross. I mean, you can imagine 10 years of grease building up. I felt like one of the T-Birds by the time I got done with it, you know.
And we did actually do research and see who said they had microwaves in stock.
Mm-hmm.
So we go to Lowe's, who said they had what we wanted for a replacement.
15 of them, right?
Yeah. There's one ancient codger staring at his computer in the appliance department. I told him, we'd like to buy this microwave. Your website says you have 15 in stock, showing him the picture on my phone. He says, ah, you can't trust anything there. I said, you don't have any? He goes, do you have any other shopping to do?
That was not a good sign.
Actually, no. I'm kind of taken with the idea of reheating soup now, but how sweet of you.
Mm-hmm.
He tells us there are some microwaves at the end of aisle 34. I'm beginning to wonder if he actually works there at this point, or if he is just a customer that likes wearing blue vests. So we get to aisle 34, and we see all kinds of on-the-counter microwaves, but we need to go farther down the aisle to get the over-the-range top ones. And of course, in front of that section, there's a big blue forklift parked right in front of the type of microwave we want.
So I go back to Mr. Maytag, and he says, that's the blue power lift. You're going to want to head over to flooring and ask them to move it for you. I went over and got the guy in flooring, by the way. And as soon as I told him, he goes, that lazy fuck. Well, he didn't hold back at all. So the guy tells me to go to flooring. I wanted to say, should I restock some shelves on the way? Maybe pick you up a corned beef sandwich on the way back? Apparently I work here now, you know.
Meanwhile, I was actually secretly trying to figure out how to move it myself, but decided it wasn't a good idea. You know, plus we were also educated that number one, you can't trust the app that tells you what aisle the products are located in inside the store. Because originally the apps told us the microwaves were, but when we got there, it was actually super overpriced toilet paper. I can only assume it's some kind of bait and switch trick to get you to buy it. Because damn, that was not even close.
Who cares about heating up food? I can go to the bathroom all day.
Two. We were also told you cannot go by the carefully placed shelf signs. Apparently, they are useless guideposts. I mean, why stock the product by manufacturer or SKU? You know, is that like asking 1,000,000% too tricky to pull that one off? And then they also said that they yell at them for empty spaces. So they fill the spots with just anything. Willy-nilly. Empty spaces be damned. Three. Customer service, despite the name, is not where you go for help or any kind of customer service. All they do is call overhead on an intercom for the cavalry, which may or may not be on break. It seems to me they just ought to cut out the middleman and leave an intercom for customers to walk up, press a button, and yell, help! I need help in microwaves! Or wherever. And then it would cut down on the customer dirty service looks for disturbing their gossip session.
About customer training on forklift driving on Thursdays. There were a lot of employees there. It wasn't like they were understaffed. There were a lot of them. They were all milling around up front. And they all acted the same way, all had the same attitude. It was like, what do you mean? You want to buy a microwave on a Sunday? Yes, I actually didn't think that was unreasonable, you know. Also, one thing, you ever notice whenever you buy an appliance from Walmart or Home Depot, there's like seven different barcode scans on it, right? And you'll never get it right. Bleep, wrong, bleep, wrong, bleep, wrong. And then they come over because you look like adult. Why do you need to have seven SKUs on there, you know? Long story short, putting it in took about 20 minutes. Buying it took 2 hours.
Horrible.
So what the hell? Anyway, but enough of our bitching. Let's play a song. Go ahead.
This is Midas Fall with In the Morning Will Be Someone Else.
Okay, let's talk about Home Chef.
Home Chef is our sponsor this week. We ourselves have been longtime customers. I have tried a lot of other meal delivery services, and Home Chef by far has the most innovative ideas, the most quality ingredients, and the most variety. I prefer the kind when I can kind of cook and prepare myself. They do have express meals or even oven ready meals. So what we have this week are the ones you actually prepare. This gets FedEx to your door. You can go in each week when the menu comes live and pick your recipes. They will give you indications of gluten options and also meat options. You can always, it's so versatile. This week, we have a buttermilk chicken schnitzel with cucumber dill sauce and zucchini. They always put together combinations I would have never put together myself. Guilt-free meat and veg meal is what we like. They offer step-by-step ingredients as you go along.
Crab, tiger, and almonds, very unusual.
This is a beef cheddar melt with roasted potato wedges. They also have on here what the difficulty is. This one says intermediate. They package everything you're going to need for the meal in a bag like this with its name on it. So all your ingredients is in here. The meat is separate. We also have sweet and spicy shrimp tacos. So that looks really good with a poblana slaw. And I have no idea what this is. They're always introducing new ingredients. Cotija? I guess we'll find out. They've had me cook with so many interesting things. Lemongrass, mangoes on steak. Then we also got one pan Southwest style vegetable quesadilla. But I did a substitution here and I subbed in some steak slices. So they give you all the like variable instructions on the back. So use our link. It will save you off your first order. And you don't have to worry about forgetting anything at the grocery store because everything's here for you. And you don't have to sit there and worry about what's for dinner because you picked everything and it's here and it's at your door. Easy peasy.
You know, interesting. I heard that the anaconda don't want... Sorry, never mind. I think it's time for collectivation. Ah, there it is. Yeah. So here's a little clip of Stace and I have started teasing the collectivation artist songs beforehand. We put this one up the other day.
Loosen up.
Come Susie dear, let's take a walk just out there beyond the beach. I know you'll soon be married and you'll want to know where winds come from. Well, it's never said at all from the mat to Carrie's. Behind the clock back there, you know.
Any idea what it is? Well, it's this. Blue Oyster Cult's Secret Treaties. That was our pathetic rendition of Astronomy.
The crown jewel of the black and white era. Blue Oyster Cult's third full length begs the question, how long can they keep this up? It's easily their strongest musically and their weirdest lyrically. The band is now fortified by hundreds of live shows caught up in the insanity of the 70s album, tour model, and still backed by the Krugman, Glielen, Perlman brain trust. Perlman's influence is everywhere, as is Patti Smyth's. Strange lyrics like the infamous "Do it to your daughter" line in the Funhouse opener Career of Evil is one of hers. Richard Melzer, Harvester of Eyes, is the most bizarre, supposedly inspired by the LBJ confirmation hearings. But who can deny the quality of that buzzing riff and guitar play key interplay? All right, let's play a song off this crazy album. This is Dominance and Submission.
And stop right now. People do the poker. Dominance. Submission. This New Year's Eve was the final barrier.
Dominant
submission.
Radio disappear.
We shook you up and we put you in the back seat.
Dominant
submission.
Radio disappear.
From year to year.
Okay, continuing on with Secret Treaties, the call and response creepiness of the song we just heard, Dominance and Submission, doesn't sound like anything recorded before or after. Probably based on some kind of kooky, apocalyptic, totalitarian rock and roll nonsense from Perlman's demented mind. But the flow of the tune is so strong, it would become a live classic for the next 20 years. The high watermark, of course, is Astronomy, their gorgeous, flowing epic of blossoming piano and spellbinding guitar. The arrangement is perhaps their best. The chemistry between Bloom, Lanier, and Dharma, especially potent. Secret Treaties is the crown jewel of the band's first era, the black and white era, a soaring collection of wild sci-fi poetry, riff muscle, and lush key workouts. And yes, those are dead dogs on the back cover. I have no idea why. Just another mystery to ponder. So, this is Astronomy.
Come Susie dear, let's take a walk.
just out there upon the beach. I know you'll soon be married, and you want to know where winds come from. Well, it's never said at all on the map that can read.
Okay, want to introduce the interview?
This is our interview with Midas Fall. I always love an interview when we have multiple band members.
Yes.
And
multiple venues.
Yeah. Multiple venues. Really like this album. It's not something that usually is up my alley, but it has totally won me over. Those songs really stick with you. This is a great album, so check it out.
Okay.
How are you, pal? You all right?
I all right. Yeah. It's just walking the dog. I was going to go camping tonight in fucking Jura, but I looked at the weather after I had said I would go, like, put to a wee spot, and it was like, oh, fuck that, it's -7 and it's pissing rain. So,
-7? Fuck.
-7, it's only 40 minutes up the road.
Wow.
So, fucking ridiculous. It's 10 degrees here, it's like balmy.
Is it usually warmer this time of year there? Or?
Rowan's a lot further north in Scotland than I am, and it's like, I don't know, I think Oban has its own ecosystem by the sense of its own microclimate.
It really does. Yeah. Like Liz, I was speaking to Liz yesterday, and she was like, oh, fucking, she had to defrost her car when she got up the other morning. I was like, oh, my car's really? Nice.
I've been like cycling to work in no jacket. It's been great.
I'm still wearing an Arctic parka.
Yeah.
It was overkill because I went on a big walk up the woods today, and it was like, I was fucking sweating by the time I was halfway through. I was like, oh, there's no way you really can appropriately dress for the weather here, because it's like, oh, it's pissing rain and then it stops and then it'll be sunny and it'll be like, oh, there's actual heat in that sun. And then that'll fuck off for a bit, and it'll be cloudy, and you'll be looking at the clouds thinking, is it going to get thundery? And then it doesn't, or it might, sometimes it does. In Glasgow, it's just like, it seems to be kind of a more even temperament down in the central.
A little bit, yeah. Although, this does just sound like Germany last week. Like, that was fucking mental. It was sunny, it was hailstones, it was snow, it was raining, it was dry, it was windy.
We're in Baltimore, and we're in April in Baltimore. It's like jacket in the morning, afternoon tank top, nighttime like long sleeves. Like, you have to use your whole wardrobe to get through the day.
Like an onion wardrobe, just like, you know, multiple layers and a fucking bag.
Exactly.
And then they're calling for it to be like summer. And today
it's supposed to be like
20
super hot.
Degrees difference between today and tomorrow. So
crazy. I've got three different weather apps on my phone, and it's like, what's the general consensus of how it's going to be? It is kind of shit. Like, I've been trapped before when there's been that flash flood, and it's like, can't get home that way. I'll just drive 60 miles round this way instead. So,
it'd be nice if they could get AI to get the, if they could get AI to predict the fucking weather properly. You know what I mean?
That would be good.
Yeah, good use of AI.
It's horrible because we're runners. So I'm constantly going, all right, is today a good night to go out, you know, after work? And it'll say partly cloudy. And I'll be like, this is the wettest partly cloudy I have ever been through.
It's a fucking lie. Just like, somebody's made that up because they're late for getting away at the pub. And just like, just fucking whatever, just say it's fishing rain, or say it's not, whatever. Anyway,
I would love to be like a weatherman or a psychic, where you can just be 100% wrong all the time and still get paid.
I think his name is Michael Fish. You might not get that reference. You should look him up though, Michael Fish. If you want to Google Michael Fish Hurricane, that's probably like the most notorious British weather fuck up there ever was. go look at that.
Very good.
Anyway, enough for the weather.
Right, shall we?
So we've really been enjoying you guys. We're kind of a little late to the party on you, but wow. So way back in the beginning, you were originally Merkin, and then where did you kind of change it to Midas Fall?
How did you know that? Where did you find that wee nugget information? I can't believe Liz isn't here.
Oh, wow.
Really fucking be defending this, not me. Wait, okay, yeah. God, that's old. Aye,
we do a lot of research, yeah.
Is this going to be like a Nardwar interview? Where is this?
What else have you fucking dug up?
Yeah, God.
Oh, I got pages here. Let's go.
Question four is, don't you think your bureau third drawer down is a little overpacked? You know.
Oh, don't even.
You've been under surveillance. Yeah.
So that was... So we were called Merkin, but we had a drummer join us for a wee while, Ben, who was lovely and sort of quite, I don't know what he's just a lovely guy, a lovely man, and he was disgusted by the name Merkin. But I think for a while we just didn't have a name. It wasn't for very long. The name of the band came about because again it was really early on, and a friend of mine was putting on this like fucking arts gig thing in Dundee and was in the photocopy shop at the time, phoned me up and was like, right, I need a fucking band name because I'm just finishing this poster off. So she was like finishing making this poster in the copy shop, was like, I need a fucking band name. So we got a dictionary and just picked two words, and then it kind of stuck. Initially it was Merkin, we liked it, but Ben was just like, oh no, I just can't think about it.
Prude.
I know, who doesn't love a pubic wig?
I know, I'd have been fine with it, for the record. I think it's a great name.
maybe that's a side project.
The Rowan and Me's like white girl. side project.
I agree with him though, because Merkin sounds like it could be a troll that hides underneath, you know, a bridge, or Midas Fall, I think, fits your big sound better.
Well, I'm glad you think so. I guess I feel kind of bad because we never really put an awful lot or any thought actually into the name.
I've always been quite annoyed at like having been in lots of bands like before Midas Fall and taking that exact same approach of like just total shot in the dark, random, I need a name. It's never worked out. I've never ended up with something as good as Midas Fall. It's always just been gibberish. Yeah.
Like, oh, really?
You guys really, that was like a one in a million shot that you would take two random words from like a dictionary and put it together and get something that is not just comprehensible, but actually like really cool.
I'm glad you think that. I don't know that I've ever really thought about it in that much depth before.
I think it's a cool name. Yeah, I think it's really good.
I'm glad you like it.
Yeah.
Well, you guys won an award, and looks like Prague Magazine gave you a Limelight Award for Evaporate. What was that like? I mean, that had to be kind of vindicating. Yeah.
So I wasn't there for that. So.
I was going to say,
no valor stealing from me.
It was kind of surreal. It was kind of nuts. It was like, all right, cool, okay, yeah. It was just like a really lovely thing to have happened. And yeah, to get kind of, I don't know, I don't really feel comfortable with the word recognition, but just kind of that, you know, you're not just pissing in the wind with it. And that was nice. It was a really lovely thing to get, and it really meant a lot as well. And I think at that point, you know, we were both going through some kind of like some fairly big sort of personal stuff, and it was something that kind of was encouraging to keep fucking doing it as well, you know. Pretty important thing, pretty huge, pretty like for us anyway. So, yeah.
I know what you mean. If somebody told us we won an award, I would be like, "All right, what are you selling?" That's the deal, you know. I'm not giving my credit card number, you know. So.
Yeah, I think if it hadn't come through, through the label, I probably would have just thought it was fucking spam. I remember the first time we ever got a gig offer through for playing abroad, and I was just like, fuck off, don't delete. That's spam. Somebody actually wants to pay us like a reasonable amount of money to do a gig. I don't fucking think so. And then they got back in touch with us again and we're like, oh, you never replied to our email. I was like, oh, right. I better reply to that. So yeah, I mean, sometimes you get like, you know, there are these really nice surprises, and try not to let cynicism get in the way too much anymore. Yeah.
Yeah, it made me kind of go back and really look, because I hadn't listened to Evaporate. So I went back and then I was like looking through because I wasn't sure. But then I was reading that it was about the winters and landscape of Iceland. Who had experiences there and how did that come about?
Oh, well, I mean, okay, so the front cover, there's a poster behind me from that's it there. That is a mountain in Iceland, and it was taken by a good friend of mine and Lizzie's, who's from Iceland. And yeah, I mean, a lot of the influences for that album were we'd moved back to Scotland, and you know, we were in a different part of Scotland than either of us had ever lived in before. And, you know, we did draw a lot of kind of, I suppose, inspiration or kind of draw creatively from the landscapes around us, from our surroundings. Iceland is quite similar in a lot of ways to the kind of more rugged parts of Scotland. And yeah, our Icelandic friend had a pretty horrendous bereavement, and that is reflected in the album. This is hard without Liz being here, because usually you know, bounce off. But yeah, I mean, it's a fucking bleak album. I mean, it's born of, you know, absolute fucking abject misery. I'm not sure. For me personally, there's not a single fucking happy note throughout that. But I can't speak for Liz, but I think, yeah, probably pretty similar. And I think, I don't know, maybe there's always something that's tinged with fucking hope, or we wouldn't still be here, would we? But yeah, the landscapes, your surroundings, and everything that kind of makes up your day-to-day existence and where you fit within everything is going to be, you know, part of whatever you create, sure, like whether it's intentional or not. So that's about the most succinct answer I can give you. Sorry.
No, that's okay. I've been to Reykjavik once, and I just remember walking around going, imagine the alcoholism here, you know. It's so bleak, and I just, you know,
yeah,
sort of feel it in the air.
Well, after the night, that we won the Prog War, the next day, I took myself off to Iceland for like a fucking Shirley Valentine holiday, for about a month, and without a jacket, I might add, which was a fucking shit idea.
Oh man.
Yeah, it was just like, I'm just gonna get a flight. I'm just gonna get a flight. Go to Iceland for a bit, Reykjavik. I didn't spend a lot of time in Reykjavik at all, but the fucking price of booze is outrageous. It cost me £90 to get 20 piss lagers, which is a fucking story. But that was like a solo thing to Iceland, and it was nice actually to kind of go back, and it felt like kind of tidy up some kind of I don't know, loose ends, I suppose, in some way. But yeah, Iceland, Scotland, misery, all go to what? Yeah. Out comes an album.
Yeah, it's so wild and different, you know. It's so untouched, you know. We kind of live close to a city, and sometimes I wish we did not.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot to be said for living in a city, but, you know, I think unless you live in a city that's, you know, you can get out of it quickly. I don't know. There's loads of stuff I miss about living in a city, but at the same time, I don't know if I could do it again. Be right in the middle of it. And I suppose we're quite lucky here because of the way that our you know, because of our geography, you know, you can get out of Glasgow fairly quickly. You know, you could probably run out of it if you had to.
Yes, you could.
Yeah.
I got to ask you the question I ask every Scottish band we interview. Who gets to claim AC/DC? Are they Australian or are they Scottish?
Well, there's a fucking statue in Kerrymuir, so...
There you go. Good answer. Yeah.
So I really, you know, after listening to you, I mean, I can, you know, have Spotify on Generate, and I know the minute you guys come on because you have such a signature sound. It's kind of like when I kind of got into Matter Mortem, their sound is also... so signature,
very distinct,
you know. Yeah. And then I ran into your covers EP and I thought, how are they gonna Midas Fall dancing in the dark and Creep? But you did it.
Yeah.
I especially loved Creep.
That turned out great.
Yeah. How did you go about picking the songs that would be on that? Or
very brave to go after a Tom York song, I think. That man's voice is a weapon, you know.
Yeah,
he's kind of like Chris Cornell, you know.
I mean, see, to be honest, like, it was kind of, like, it was pretty much just, like, a way of keeping ourselves occupied during lockdown, to be honest. I think Liz and Rowan, like, between them had, like, some, you know, old sort of unfinished demos or things that they started or had been working on for a while that were just kind of rattling around. And, you know, the way that when lockdown was happening, it sort of, you know, made making an album just a little bit slower than normally would have, because you know you can't kind of do the things that we normally can and the world was on fire and so on. So I think we were just it was just something that we were able to do remotely, to be honest, like to kind of break up the process of working on the album. And I mean, for my part, I basically just got sent sort of these ideas in some kind of basic form. Some were more developed than others, and yeah, I just got asked to put some bass to it and anything else that I wanted to. And then I just kind of, yeah, it was just one of those little, it's so difficult to answer, but because it was in the midst of lockdown that we made them, it's just, I have quite a hard time remembering it. Because, you know, like everybody else, we were in just survival mode and nobody knew which way was up and so on. So, it was just a way to break up the album cycle, to be honest. And, I think we kind of knew the album was like maybe taking a while again because of, you know, lockdown and so on. Like, it wasn't because we were, you know, it wasn't because we were running out of ideas or didn't know what we wanted to do with the album or anything. I think it was just, you know, things took a while because of the way things were. So it was, I think it was just a way of being able to just sort of remind people that we are actually, you know, still a thing and still alive, and then, you know, try and whet people's appetite a little bit. But yeah, it was cool. And it was just nice being able to, I think another reason as well was, you know, you could probably hear quite a difference in sound between Evaporate and Cold Wave Dividers in lots of ways. And obviously I wasn't here for the last album, but I was here for Cold Wave Dividers. So I think it was also a way for me to sort of just show Liz and Rowan like what I could maybe do other than just play bass, which up until that point was all I'd really done for the band. I hadn't been involved in anything like creatively. So yeah, I think it was just a way for me to show what I could do on the sort of production side and maybe what else I could bring to the table. And in some ways, maybe that sort of influenced how the album was developed in terms of, you know, what I was able to do for my part other than just play bass. So, but yeah, the covers EP was, yeah, it was cool.
I liked it. Neat the way you... I hate covers that sound exactly the same as the original. Like, why did you do that? I just don't get it.
I think as well,
ripped it apart and put it back. I love it.
No, thank you very much, guys. We appreciate that.
God, I'm thinking about during lockdown. I remember Metallica did a acoustic version of Blackened, and then they did like a country version of No Remorse. I was like, congratulations, you've made lockdown worse.
Yeah, you've somehow done it.
Just giving him advice. Nobody wants to hear this stuff, you know.
Yeah. I think for me as well, so I used to play, not anymore, but I used to play in a wedding band. That was like my kind of full-time gig for a while. And to do that full-time, you have to play a lot of weddings, and it takes its toll. You know, it ruins a lot of songs for you. And Dancing in the Dark is, you know, one of them, and so is Creep. You know, very like good songs, but very popular songs. So yeah, I think that was what I liked about it. When I got the demos over, I was like, oh, I know these songs, but they are so different from the originals. Yeah. That I don't know. It was.
Asked to play them a lot. Weddings, Creep, and
Dancing. Oh God! Yeah, yeah. Oh, which I think the irony is lost on people about the lyrical content of being tired and bored with yourself, and meanwhile I'm on stage, just dead behind the eyes.
Yeah.
But I now have a job that I really like, so it's okay. But it was a nice way for me to sort of, I guess, just enjoy those songs again. So
coming up, The Cold Waves Divide Us. I love that crazy album cover with the humongous jellyfish. Yeah. who kind of got the idea that should be the cover? It's very luminescent.
Yeah.
It was actually from an old drummer of ours, Stephen Pedro Pilat. He played drums with us on the As Our Blood Separates EP, the Fluorescent Lights EP, Wilderness, and the Menagerie albums. So we saw this for quite a while, and then when we moved back to Scotland, he stayed down in the northwest of England, but he did a lot of work as a graphic designer and stuff, so he got in touch around when, I can't remember now, because Liz was saying, oh, Pedro's message, and I hadn't seen it, and anyway, yeah, he got in touch, and we just kind of got chatting, and he had some really nice ideas for the art. So jellyfish, yeah.
Yeah, I don't really know where the jellyfish came from.
I remember when Liz first sort of showed me some of the kind of mock-ups or like ideas or whatever that Pedro had come up with, and they were all really good. I really liked the jellyfish, despite the fact that at the time they were the bane of my fucking life because they were all over the bay here. And trying to get fucking jellyfish is a pain in the arse. At that point, I was like, I don't want to see any more fucking jellyfish. But I really love the art, and I think he made a fantastic job of it. Really love it.
Yeah, because I don't think any of us specifically asked for a jellyfish, or even, like, I don't know what kind of direction Pedro had. I think he just kind of gave us that, and then once we saw it, we were like, oh, this is cool. Like, I like this. Yeah. So, weird.
I don't know. Maybe Liz suggested a jellyfish. I don't know. I don't think so.
Yeah, that's, I don't know.
Yeah, well, it fits because, like, you know, where we are, you know, our ocean, and if you go north, it always seems like there's tons of jellyfish because it's colder. But if you go, like, to South Carolina, where it's warm all the time, no jellyfish.
Really?
Yeah, I prefer that beach down there.
Yeah, I was going to say they'll be
here. I didn't realize that. You're right.
Although I haven't seen here yet. No, just as an aside.
Yeah, people.
This lady I work with, she was swimming. She was in Europe on vacation, and she got stung by jellyfish, and her one toe turned black.
And her what?
Yeah, her toe turned black from it. And I remember I was dying for her to come back because I was like, do you still have 10 toes? Like, I was dying. they saved it. So then, like, every time I'd see her, if she was having a bad day, I'd say, hey, at least you got 10 toes, you know?
That's true. I'm going to tell myself that. Like, at least I have 10 toes, no matter how bad things get.
It's the little things, yeah.
So, Michael, you had seemed to have kind of seamlessly joined this previous duo, and it seems like you guys have kind of meshed. Was it easy for you to kind of fall into this band and kind of become the third leg on the stool?
I think so, yeah. I think, you know, when I got the offer to play with the guys, like, you know, I was already a fan of the band for one thing, and I was already like playing this kind of music, and also, well, I was also trying to make this kind of music like by myself, just as like a kind of solo thing. But then when I heard Midas Fall, I was like, oh wow, like this is what Liz and Rowan are able to produce together is like so much bigger and better than anything I could do myself. So I think just the idea, I understood what they were doing, and I think just the idea of being able to be a part of something that, you know, could mean that the thing that I was trying to do could turn into something, I could like put that into something bigger than what I'd be able to do by myself. I think that's what kind of motivated me. And yeah, I think it was just, you know, I think we just get along well, to be honest. Like,
it's important.
I think that we were talking about this on tour quite a lot, and just because we recently, a friend of mine kind of stepped in to start playing drums for us, and you know, the tour had its kind of ups and downs, and just shit went wrong at every possible turn, and things were breaking, and like, you know, it was pretty hard at points, but it's very much like just like that's just DIY touring for you, you know.
Right.
Like, I think so. There's so many musicians out there that would be like, oh my God, I'm not doing that again, because they just like, they just can't hack that sort of, don't know, that really often romanticized kind of DIY part of touring, whereas I'd done that a bunch before. And so when I was doing it with them, or the prospect of doing it with them, it was fine. You know, I wasn't ever, there were no tantrums for me, because I was like expected to be treated better, or like, oh, I'm uncomfortable, or I'm tired, or I'm this and I'm that. Like, you know, Liz and Rowan have done it long enough that they know the score and they just fucking get on with it. And so did I, even though I hadn't done it with them up till that point. So I think, yeah, we were just always on the same page in that respect.
Yeah.
Even before, you know, I think there are people that who like, you know, are probably better than me at playing bass, or like better than me at like, you know, doing synths or whatever. But I think that's the important stuff to survive in a band, is just being able to sort of spend a lot of time with each other without falling out. It's just, right. And I think that's what I was able to do, just because we, you know, we got along so well, I think. So
yeah, you can really see the chemistry you guys have in like your Instagram posts and stuff. It comes through for sure.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, it's nice. I really like, you know, it's, even playing live is always when it like really comes together for me. Just like, I don't know, I've played so many gigs with that I've just kind of showed up and done the job and got paid and left. But just every single gig, no matter what happens before it, or how difficult things were, or like everything that went wrong or whatever, I think every time I go on stage with like Liz and Rowan and like Callum now, it just feels like, I don't know, it just feels, I just feel like I'm a part of something bigger than myself, and that's just a feeling that all musicians really want, I think. And it's, I don't know, every single time I play a gig with those guys, I always get that feeling, and that's what keeps me around, I think.
It's a really, really nice mix or fit or whatever the whatever the fuck I'm trying to say, it fits now. And I don't feel like in the past, like anything has clicked quite as well, or has felt as, I suppose, natural and easy to just do what we're doing. And, you know, I don't think the value of that can be overstated. It's very lovely having you with us, Michael. And
it's lovely having you.
The tour we just did there, yeah, it was a fucking nightmare from beginning to end. But it was all external stuff. It was nothing to do with, you know, it was not, like, fuck all to do with anything within band dynamics or you know, with any of the very well organized shows. It was, you know, it was all just fucking shit going on in the background and things breaking, amps breaking, fucking strings breaking. So I've not broken a string in fucking years. Boom. you know, shit like that. And it's like, I think there seems to be like a kind of a good understanding that, you know, it's all right to for everybody to have, if they need it, their fucking Wingstop girl moment, and you know, but it'll be fine after that, you know.
Yeah.
But it's, yeah, you're a very level-headed, calming influence, I think, when things are really, really fucking difficult. Like, when it's just like, how do we fix this problem? when we might just be kind of losing our shit with it. But, you know, it's really good. It's a really nice, really comfortable mix of people now. And I could not be happier with how things are.
It definitely shows. And we had a few track questions about this album.
Okay.
So, am I wrong? This seemed to me, after listening to the other album, it's a very angry song for Midas Fall.
Oh, yeah.
is it kind of about like a toxic relationship? And was, do you know if it was based on like a real event or art or kind of a blending of everything?
Well,
oh god, lyric questions.
I mean, like, Liz does the lyrics, some of the titles for the tracks are working titles that I've written, and then Liz has written lyrics around that. But yeah, the singing stuff, that's Liz. So I couldn't speak to, you know, necessarily where she's coming from with that, but yeah, I am wrong. The music for that, it stemmed from an idea. It was a long time ago, actually. It'd been floating around. In a really fucking angry, pissed off place. I think I was fucking raging when I started that song. and so it shows. But you know, again, it's like the way things work, you know, come up with an idea and then it'll get kind of passed around, and you know, sometimes it'll become a song and sometimes it'll just go in the fucking bin, and that's fine. So this one floated around for a wee bit and stayed angry, but
yeah. I remember because I don't know how sort of fleshed, I can't really remember how fleshed out it was by the time I heard it, but like even if it's most like in a primitive form before I ever, like, you know, did my parts, it was it still had that I don't know, I feel like, yeah, it just had this energy to it, and that I just hadn't, I don't know, I hadn't heard in any other Midas Fall songs at that point, or like even in a lot of sort of later contemporaries, I guess. It had this sort of urgency and aggressiveness to it, and I remember immediately sort of being like, oh, that's like, I see the potential in that, like that's gonna be great when it's done. And it was really cool because it was like, I think it was quite a basic sort of primitive idea by the time I did it, and then by the time I heard it, and then I did like my bass parts, and you know, it maybe some like synths or whatever, I can't remember, but then I sort of sent it back to Liz and Rowan, kind of forgot about it, and then got it back again, and it just sounded,
it's got a
basically they started something, I took it and ran with it, I gave it back to them, they took what I did and ran with it even further, and it's just this sort of feedback loop that the emotion was clear from the beginning, but it just got bigger and bigger and bigger and more extreme as we, in quite an organic way, even though we were doing it by like in quite a digital sort of sterile way, that there was still had this kind of organic development to it that I really, really liked. And I think that's the same for all the album, for most of the album tracks, to be honest. Just had to adapt to working remotely like the rest of the world, you know, so I think that's what it was. But yeah, I love that song. It's really, There's a point where, like, I think there's pretty much, like, well, the bit at the end where it's just, like, Liz is, like, you know, sort of, like, wailing, and, like, Rowan and I are just basically hitting the lowest open strings on our, like, new toys at that point, yeah, essentially, because, yeah, I think that was, it was like Rowan had her new baritone guitar. I had my new 5-string bass, and like it was just like, I don't know. I always look forward to that part of the song and that part of the set because it's just, don't know. It just has this gravitas to it that it's just quite special. I don't know. I'm struggling to articulate exactly, but yeah, you clearly picked up on it too, which is nice. Yeah. So thank you.
How did the video come about? Like, it was that? I guess it's in an actual train station or subway.
Yeah, it's like an underpass or like a tunnel in Glasgow, or several tunnels actually. Yeah, the video came about basically, you know, the album was done and we were deciding on like singles to put out and stuff like that, and the label basically said, right, you have this budget and we need 3 videos. So we had to sort of like, and it, you know, it was a lot of money. It was a very generous amount of money, but also still, we still had to put quite a lot of thought into making the most of that money. Yeah, like, so we did that. And then basically the guy that directed it was a guy that I also like do film scoring as well. And I did the music for his first feature film that came out last year called The Labyrinth. And the director, Stephen Alexander, we just kind of help each other out with work whenever we can. So he also took our pictures that you'll have seen in like the press shots and stuff like that. And yeah, it just came where we're just like, right, who do I know that can do a lot with a little? Because I know from working on The Labyrinth, the feature film, that was totally self-funded. It was like less than £2,000, and he managed to make a feature film just by knowing the layout of Glasgow and being able to work with it so well. And I was like, right, that's what we need. So I just asked him to help us out with the music video. And I knew that Amber, who is the lead woman in it, was also the lead woman in that feature film. She is an incredible actor, but is actually like a dancer by trade. So I was like, oh, okay, that can be another quite compelling way to make, you know, something quite compelling without having to spend a lot of money on it. So I think it just kind of came from like, yeah, so I had like, you know, we asked those guys to be involved and thankfully they said yes. And then with the band then had to try and come up with like, right, okay, what idea can we do that's not going to be a lot of money? Something that doesn't involve lights, something that doesn't involve a big crew, something that doesn't involve like all this sort of stuff. And you know, I'm from Glasgow and I knew Stephen. Stephen's really good. Like I said, I knew Stephen knows how to like just make Glasgow seem like this otherworldly sort of fictitious place, like Gotham or, you know, something like that. And I was just thinking Rowan and I are like really into like our horror films and stuff like that. So I just started thinking of like, right, well, what films do I like that I know doesn't have a lot of budget, but we're still able to make these like incredible, like otherworldly scenes. So we were thinking of a lot of like giallo films, and also Possession came to mind, which, you know, absolutely hellscape of a film, but had virtually no budget and people are still talking about it today. So I think we were just kind of borrowing ideas from that sort of approach to kind of DIY filmmaking. Again, very much in line with our ethos as a band of just DIY touring, self-producing, self-writing, self-recording all of our albums. And we were like, well, we managed to make it work in every other respect. So, you know, surely a video should be no different. And yeah, it was basically just trying to copy what every other kind of DIY artist has ever done in our own kind of way. And yeah, it ended up looking like the I Am Wrong video.
Yeah, it was really, really well done. The other one that really got us was the Cool Waves Divide Us video.
All right, yeah. All right. On that one, right? She's never done mushrooms. So I told her, now that you've seen that video, you don't need to.
No, you really don't.
There it is.
yeah. agree with that. Yeah. The cold waves. I was really happy with how the cold waves video came out. I mean, you know, that was
Yeah, that was another again, we were just sort of like talking to our record label and we were just like brainstorming of like, right, okay, how can we get three videos out of this like quite limited budget? And she was talking and she just mentioned this artist, as in like music artist, who I think is also on Monotreme, but they have like a project as this like weird sort of experimental ambient or like experimental kind of generative music thing. I forget the name of the project, that's really bad, but as part of that project I think he also does these sort of visuals that are generated the same way you as part along with the music kind of thing. Like it's the sort of thing like people will watch that video and just think like, oh, it's just more like AI schlock, and it's like, well, no, it's not. Like it was, you know, it was sort of made in turn by an artist who is experimented with like generative music. So, and that's something I'm really interested in. So I think it was just a recommendation of like, yeah, you know, this guy's really good at making a lot from nothing. So we just kind of asked Kim, the head of Monotreme, to just put us in touch. And I think we basically just sent him the music and was just like, well, what do you think would work? And he sort of went along, it went down that path of that narrative path that ended up being in a music video. Like, yeah, there was a few iterations, but it was always headed in that direction right from the concept. There was never any massive overhauls or anything. It was always sort of, the visuals were always kind of along those lines as they ended up, which is pretty cool. Again, very organic, you know. I really like that, just giving the music to people and just being like, well, what do you think? You know, what does it make you think of? And that's clearly where it took him, which is cool. So yeah,
it was neat how like the movement of the music went with the movement of the visuals. So it's really quite effectual.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so... very mushroom-esque. Yeah. I think we'll all agree.
Fun fact, Salt was written on mushrooms.
Was it?
Yeah. I fucking banged a load of mushrooms and went around the forest and worked my way through Evaporate, and then felt like I'd come out the other side of it, and then went and wrote Salt. That's how Salt was born. It was tripping out my fucking nut.
Okay.
Is it Longview by Green Day? Wasn't like the intro to that, wasn't like Mike Dern on like acid or something? And they like couldn't. I think there was like some story where like, I think he wrote it when he was on acid or mushrooms or something like that, and he couldn't, like he had to basically take it again to remember what it was. I don't know if that's just like urban myth or not, but it's cool. It's cool to believe, so I'm going to believe it. Or it's cool story to believe, so I'm going to believe it.
I think that probably is quite believable because see that like not the main guitar line, but a lot of the fucking background guitar stuff, that was all the original recordings. I don't have a fucking clue how I'd done it. On there, and thankfully they're just kind of soundscapey things, so they don't need to be recreated in a live environment. They can just stay there.
So do you just need to take mushrooms before you go on stage, and then you won't need all the cues anymore? Is that?
Oh my god! Imagine, it would be fucking terrible. Like,
oh. Yeah, just spend all the time just looking at the back of your hands, like. Whoa.
Yeah.
Or if that string broke, you just look at that. Huh?
Yeah.
When I was in high school, we used to think that you couldn't trip 2 days in a row. And then we met this guy that was into the Grateful Dead, and he said, all you got to do is double the dose.
Yeah.
But that created a whole new set of problems because you're exponentially doubling. Yeah.
So
that was bad advice, of course, actually. So,
Of course, it's the Grateful Dead guy tells you how to trip for two days.
Of course.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was a really weird guy. He was a guy like we would go to lunch and he would eat everything, like anything we didn't finish, he would eat. It was just, he was so gross. It was just kind of, just feed him here. Yeah. It was crazy. Anyway.
So Also, I did like a different approach you took for In the Morning Will Be Someone Else, where it was like a studio recording. Is that kind of what it looks like when you're recording, or was that specifically done for that video?
Oh,
the live session.
Mm-hmm.
No, that's yeah. Well, I guess it's kind of funny because, like, well, I, you know, this is my first album that I've worked with the band, and it was through COVID. So, you know, we did the whole album remotely, basically. I think Liz and Rowan went back and forth a bit more because they live closer to each other than I do to either of them. But it's weird. It's like, even though I've worked on one album with the band now, and, like, you know, the EP, I don't know. Because it was under such weird circumstances, I don't know how normal that process is. You know, like, I don't know. Maybe the next album will be more like that, because hopefully we won't have a pandemic to, like, worry about. But yeah. I don't know. But no, for that video, we basically just, it was more inspired by how we played live than how the track was recorded in the first place. Even though it's in a room and it's not on a stage and stuff like that, I think we very much just approached it of, right, we'll just do it like we're at a gig, rather than, oh, okay, we need to remember how we made this in the first place so we could do that again. Like,
I would say it's totally faithful to how we would necessarily play at a show, I think.
Yeah.
I feel like a bit of a tit, you know, kind of bumping around and, you know, doing the things you do, you get lost in a live show, you know?
Yes.
But it's good to have live videos to be like, you know, we can actually play these songs.
Yeah. I think me and Rowan are usually much more animated on stage than we are in that video. Yeah, so because we were all tethered by, you know, headphones and cables and stuff like that. Right. So sound is very much there, but in terms of how we are as performers, very different. Yeah. But usually Rowan and I are like dripping in sweat and like about to fucking collapse when we come off stage.
Uh-huh. All right, so we have a game that we play. Normally, if it's one person, we'll do 5 random questions, but since it's 2 of you, we'll do 3 each.
Okay.
I don't know why the lesbian bed desk thought this was terrifying, she said, but it's really not that scary.
I'm just going to go and put this lamp on because I'm aware it's like fucking vampire dark in here.
Yeah, looking forward to the game.
Okay.
All right.
So there's 100 questions, so each of you pick 3 numbers between 1 and 100.
Okay, you want to go first, right?
Three numbers. Any number between 1 and 100.
Right, yes. Right.
All right, 55.
All right, 2 more.
Fuck. 27 and 33.
You said 27 and 33?
Yeah. Okay. 55, 27, 33. I'm going
to go Michael, give me 3 numbers.
Oh, my turn. 7, 35, 74. Like numbers. What numbers do I know?
All right. We'll start with Rowan. You picked 55. Name a person you would love to see in the audience at your show. Could be alive or dead.
I've got no fucking idea. usually it's just anybody that wants to be there. it's like, you're coming. I don't know. I think if I really wanted anybody to be there in particular, I'd shit myself and fuck it up. Fuck knows. Maybe just probably just my sister. Like, fucking get out the house for a night. Come on.
That's a good answer.
Yeah, my sister.
Can I grab this thing?
Yeah, this is a good time.
Hold on. Speaking of technical difficulties, we need to grab a plug.
I gotta grab a plug.
It's all good. Don't worry about it.
All right. So we'll keep on going. Number 27. If you founded your own country, what would you name it?
If I had my own country? The Independent Republic of Fuck You.
If I were to guess what Rowan would call her own country, I think that's pretty much exactly what I would say.
Yeah,
the the Democratic Republic of Go Fuck Yourself.
Yes.
Right, number 33. What quality is a complete deal breaker when you're dating someone?
I think I'm the fucking deal breaker.
come on.
I wish somebody would tell me. so stop fucking doing it. I don't know. Manky fingernails. That's fucking rank. No excuse at all.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah, sometimes you don't know stuff about it until you date someone. But I dated this guy for a long time, and then when we finally, I knew he played online video games. When we finally moved in together, I didn't realize he would play until like 3 a.m. From like 6, I was like, oh no, this is ridiculous.
That's definitely not honesty. I enjoy playing computer games. That's beyond that. But
you know, I was like, are you gonna come to bed? He's like, no, I gotta be in a dungeon. I'm like, what?
I can't pause the game.
But they play online with all their friends, and you know, they're all there. I'm just like, I can't do this.
When I was a boy, it was the arcade games was all there was. And you know, you had your top score. You could only put your initials in.
Yes.
We knew each other's initials in the neighborhood. So I would see R-Y-N, I'd be like, fucking Robert. And then the greatest joy would be, I'd spend all afternoon in the sub shop playing Galaga and getting myself, my initials back up top. And then in class, I'd be like, might want to go check out that Galaga.
God,
that's how old school I am.
Well, I can understand that because like, you are having to go out and participate in the real fucking world to go and access a machine. But I don't really get the whole, you know, holding yourself up and disconnecting.
Yeah, it's totally different now,
in reality.
Yeah.
I wouldn't like that. I could probably tolerate it, but if they were sitting there with a fucking control pad glued to their fingers and they had manky fingernails, that would be fuck that, out.
Well, plus we would do anything to rag on each other back then. Anything. There was nothing better than just poking each other and, you know, starting shit, you know, so.
Yeah. Michael, number 7, what is the first thing you do when you wake up in the morning?
Practice my Japanese, as Rowan will know.
I didn't see that one coming at all.
Whoa. Yeah, I've got a cool 90-day streak on Duolingo. I'm killing it. Kept it up all through tour. Yes, I have a coffee and I will practice my Japanese.
Now, are you learning to write it too, or just speak it?
I'm learning to write it, but I'm terrible at it. It's mostly listening and speaking. But
is it really all pictures, or is there a limit to the letters, or like?
So there's three different alphabets.
Oh my
which
god!
Is mad. So like. There's hiragana, which is like the most common one, which is like phonetic, like, you know, they're syllables that you join together to make words. Okay. And there is katanika, which is the same idea, but it's for like romanized words, like borrowed words from like other languages. They'll spell them out using katanika, which is a lot simpler. It's a lot more basic looking. And then there's kanji, which is like the picture one, where there are like every word has its own unique combination of squiggles, which I've not even started with that yet. But I think, I've not really given it too much time because I know that it's like, it's not that I'm not trying to read it. And also I've been to Japan a few times and it's like, you can read everything that you need to read is at least romanized. So even if it's, being able to understand what people are saying and having a conversation is so much more important.
Yeah.
And it's funny actually, because like from reading like a lot of Japanese books and stuff like that, or like Japanese like literature, it's, there'll be a lot of, it's still quite common that like you won't necessarily know, there's still a lot of people that can't read that much kanji, for example, even like native Japanese people. It's weird. I'm still trying to figure out what the kind of deal is with it, but hiragana is the most common one that you'll see.
The kanji's for if you're training karate students in your backyard.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Kanji's just for writing, like for me, I don't know, if you've got my favorite thing in the world is for when people take like really on the nose, like, you know, just really mundane English words for things or really uninspired names for things, but then make it cool by translating it to Japanese. Like the best example being, the best example being, you were talking about video games. You remember the video game Tekken?
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, there's a bear in it that you can like play as, and the bear is called Kuma.
Yeah.
Do you know what the Japanese word for bear is?
No.
Kuma. So the bear is just called bear. But you think it, you don't think it, you don't think twice about it, because like, oh, you're like, oh, Kuma, oh, that Kuma the bear. Yeah. I'm like, no, it's Bear the Bear. Like, that's what he's called.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, I ended up getting a degree in German when I was in school, and there's certain words that just, you can't really translate them into English. Like, I love the word Warschlappen, which is like something that you'd call like the wife would call the husband as like a dig. It literally means you're a dish rag.
there's a lot of things like that in German. It's really cool.
Another good word is Vernichtung, which is to destroy, but in German it literally means to make into nothing, which I always thought that was a really cool word. You know, I picture like the atomic bomb.
I've always loved how literal the German language is.
Very literal, yeah. Very.
Yeah,
literal.
It's great.
Yeah, my high school teacher used to call us Dummköpfchen, my little Dummköpfchens, right? And we didn't know. And then in college one day, it just hit me. I was like, she was calling us little shitheads.
But she did it so affectionately.
It.
Yeah.
It was like my little shitheads, you know.
Oh, what is it? Dummköpfchen.
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 She threw shin on the end, you know.
Like right. Liebchen.
Like Liebchen. And, you know, then it was right. Okay, right? My little Dummköpfchen.
Whatever. That's great. Yeah, that's what I do.
Yeah.
All right, number 35. What is the farthest distance you have ever run?
I did a 10K once, so probably that. Yeah.
Yeah.
I hate running though. I love cycling. I do that all the time, so I can cycle like for, you know, forever and not get bored of it. But running fucking sucks. I hate it. Like, I like to stay fit and stuff like that, but I just cannot get into running. But cycling, yeah, it's cool.
I always used to run out by this reservoir by us they close at the traffic. And of course, there's all kinds of people. But I noticed most of the guys were on bikes, most of the women were running. And I was thinking about it. And I was like, you know what? Because they need a machine to exercise, and we are the machine.
Exactly. Exactly.
little bicycling humor. All right, 74. How long would you survive in a zombie apocalypse?
Right. Oh god, this is when I act like, oh, I've got it all figured out, and then you immediately poke holes in like all my plans. I'd like to think, right, in zombie films, there's like one of the reasons why they all do so poorly is because zombie films don't exist in the universe of zombies films, right? You know, like yeah. if they had seen Night of the Living Dead and Night of the Living Dead, they probably would have been a little bit better because they were like, ah, I know what to do. So I'd like to think that, like, because I have watched a lot of zombie films as a like lover of all things horror, I would like to think I would do at least better than the people in zombie films, purely by virtue of that. The fact that I've at least seen a zombie film.
Right.
So, how long would I last?
Fucking no time in the center of Glasgow, you'd be fucked.
That's true, yeah. If we're talking about right now, I'd be pretty fucked, yeah. If I could get out of Glasgow into like somewhere a bit more remote, which isn't that far, but yeah, mm-hmm. If I'm overrun, but I mean, to be fair, no, I would do fucking amazing because I've seen zombie films and I also work in a music shop in like one of the roughest parts of Glasgow. So I see zombies daily. It's like coming in and out of the shop. So fucking that's just another Tuesday, man. I'd be fine. I would last forever. I've been dealing with a zombie apocalypse since I started this job.
Yeah, I worked at a music store in my 20s and I would help repair band instruments, and I was amazed at how these parents let these kids destroy these instruments that they've rented. Like I'd open up the clarinet case and it was like they had been fighting with swords. All the buttons were broken off of it and stuff.
Yeah.
And I just remember being like, they just let the kids beat each other senseless with trumpets. I mean, what are you doing? You know, like
it's funny, but for me, like, so I work for Roland, I work like inside a music shop. So I'm like their representative in there. So I'm in charge of like all the like the synthesizers and drum machines and stuff like that. So, and you know, and also digital pianos. So there are lots of, you know, well-to-do people that come in and want to spend like 10 grand on a, you know, a grand piano for their new living room or whatever. Not from Glasgow. That's like once every 6 months that'll happen. Okay. But my daily is mostly just like people coming in, like, you know, like haven't been to bed yet, they've been up for 3 days like partying and they're like, yeah man, I'm gonna come in and make some techno, like, ooh, like, and they want me sell them a drum machine. I'm like, dude, you don't even know what planet you're on, like, never mind, start making techno. Come on, man. So yeah,
is it really like that? I never thought it was like that fucking nuts. I didn't
that's
even
try
it
that's
was rough. Is it
that's
rough?
Tron Gate baby, that's
nice.
No, it's okay. It's just like it's a bit, you know, it's right next to the East End, you know. It's not exactly it's pretty rough at points, like it's kind of at the border of civilization. Like any more east you're into like Barra's territory, you know.
Yeah, which is a lot of fun, I have to say.
Nah, like, that's true.
They're in out of Glasgow, but I don't live there, so I don't have to tolerate whatever nonsense you've got to put up with on a daily basis.
Exactly. I would be fine.
You know, it's funny, like when you were saying about, you know, going somewhere more remote, because honestly, I think at the beginning of the pandemic, a lot of people treated it like it was a fucking zombie apocalypse, because the amount of fucking camper vans that showed up here, and they were all told to get the fuck. It was like, no. Get fucking go home, right? No, you can't just come here. We've got fuck all as it is. Boost. That was kind of the approach of the Scottish government at the time. They're like, nah, fuck off. Back to where you came from. There's no.
I didn't know that. They wanted you to all get in, what, in buses and stuff?
No. Like when we were about to lock down, and I'm talking like a couple of days before, like, because I live fucking in the middle of nowhere. And Liz even more so, that like all these fucking camper vans appeared, and it was people coming from densely populated areas.
Oh, okay, I see. Okay.
We'll go somewhere fucking remote, and we'll not get the fucking zombie apocalypse treatment. Like, nah, but, fuck off.
Wow.
But right? They were the zombies. That's...
Get away! You've just come from the city. Fuck off. Yeah, right? Yeah. We don't have enough facilities here to cope all your pish. Beat it. Yeah. But I have to say, being up here through the like fucking pandemic and looking out there, and it's like, that's not a zombie apocalypse at all. It was fucking business as usual. Because there was nobody coming in. It's all very much self-contained. That just kind of reminded me when you were saying about going somewhere more remote. I was like, aha, yeah, everybody else had that fucking idea.
Don't come here. Right, don't come here.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I was working in a restaurant, and of course, we could only do carry out. You know, so they would call in and they'd let us know, we'd run it out to the car. And we were even selling, because we had draft beer that was going to go bad. So we would sell draft beer in like a big soup container, and just these two guys came in. They're like, can we drink it in the parking lot? I'm like, I don't care.
Yeah, they did that in Glasgow too. They would, like, you could go to a bar. The bars were open, but you couldn't go inside or stay inside. But you could go in, buy the thing, and come back out. But it's also very it's illegal to like drink in the streets in Scotland, and they're like, you know, they're quite hard line about it.
Yeah.
But it was just like pretty laissez-faire for that sort of that weird time.
Nobody cared. The laws of society no longer applied.
Yeah, that was it. Law of the jungle, man. That was. Yeah. But yeah, I think I'd be fine. Is my answer.
So Midas Falls has such a big cinematic feel to it. And I believe I read somewhere that it was in a documentary as part of the soundtrack. Are you in any other a movie or video games approached you to have be in there? Because that'd be a great idea.
That would be a good idea, wouldn't it? It'd be nice to be fucking pension. And it wasn't a documentary. It was a BBC TV program that was on quite a long time ago. That was cool. That was great. It'd be really lovely to have some of our music used for, you know, like movies, documentaries, you know, whatever. That would be cool. But I'm aware that there is just so much competition when it comes to music syncing, and it's really, really hard to get a break in that kind of way. I think some of it is just fucking luck, like somebody that's in a position where they are, you know, tasked with putting a soundtrack to a movie or a TV show or whatever, and they hear your song and they think it's right for that. I mean, it's like, how much fucking stuff has to align for that to actually happen? A lot of fucking.
Yeah.
I think you guys should have, like, you know, be on the opening credits for the next James Bond movie. That would fit.
Yeah.
I like it.
Wow. That would be like the most depressing like James Bond film ever. Like
Taylor Swift to sing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Something, you know.
Skyfall was like, you know, da-da, you know.
Yeah.
That's true.
It was
Adele.
Adele, that's right. Yeah.
Maybe we need to cover that Adele track and be like, look,
Yeah, exactly.
See,
you
hear your cover of Radiohead, you know. Yeah,
I mean, here, you know, Jack White can do it. You know, it's not the Chris Cornell can do it. You know, it's not out with the realm of possibility. But
someone called us once the White Stripes of podcasting. So I was like, I'll take it. Whatever.
Like, but we're not divorced.
That kind of reminds me of like when we did the first album and we were getting reviews for that, and it was just like we were just getting compared to anybody that had a female singer.
That's a cop out. A lot of reviewers.
Yeah.
It's just fucking lazy. But you know, like, fair enough, whatever. I think people see what's in front of them and sometimes don't necessarily go too far beyond that. Oh, well.
I guess. Some of the comparisons are so weird, but it's like, I don't know. It's just, Yeah, as I don't know, even before joining Midas Fall, as it always really fucking bugged me how I've like every guitar, every band with a guitar and a woman singing was just Paramore, you know. Yeah. Or if they were Goths, they were Evanescence, you know. Like, yeah, it was, you know, it was, there are two archetypes for bands with female vocalists, and as one of those, like, come on, like, it's so fucking stupid.
Evanescence, like, that used to absolutely do let his fucking head in, and it was like, which was like, for fuck's sake, we're nothing fucking like Evanescence. Like, I know. You'd never hear Nautical Song on an Evanescence album, would you? Would you fuck?
But I keep saying, though, we need to get a rapper. Like, we need to. Man, talking about sinking, we need a rap bridge. Then we'll be in the new Daredevil movie and it'll be fine. Word for Evanescence.
I was at a bar with some friends one night and we were talking about music reviews, like, what are the worst music reviews and what are the worst things they do, like, you know, writing overlong sentences, using 50-cent words that nobody wants to hear. Bad comparisons. Anyway, I started like writing them down on a napkin, and then I went and wrote a review where I had all of it in.
Oh,
I was so proud of it. I was like, this has every bad thing we talked about in this review. So
yeah,
name dropping and pretentious, and yeah, so I was very proud of it.
We had a really scathing review of Evaporate, but I think I started talking to you about this when we were on tour. But it was so well written. And it was really fucking funny. And like, you know, like, if I heard this coming on in a nightclub, I'd immediately go and fucking kill myself.
Yeah. And, like, whoa, 10 out of 10. Great. That's exactly what we want.
No, it was far more eloquently written than that. And the song, kind of, you'll see it on our Twitter feed if you go quite far down it, probably. And it was like all like fucking new agey bullshit. And it was just so funny that when it you know, where you put all your good bits, you know, all your reviews together for all your press fucking stuff, I was like, that needs to go in there because it's brilliant. Yeah. It's really funny. I mean, she hated it.
Yeah, if you can write, yeah, I agree. If a reviewer can write really well, I can 180 degrees disagree with them, but I'll still read it because it's entertaining. But on the other hand, there's a writer at Cream Magazine. I won't say who he is. But I hate him. I hate the way he writes. He does everything that I hate, right? So I wrote, I send them mails. And I said, like, last week I sent them a message. And I said, if the only options in life were reading Zach's reviews and watching my toenails grow, I would be wearing sandals right now. So I'm hoping that they publish that, you know? So
I think, though, like, it's... there's definitely something to be said for like finding, finding like joy and those kinds of things. Cause it's like, especially like, see when people are just like, it's just so fucking hyperbolic, you know, when like, even if you don't like the Midas Falls music, like, sure, okay. Like, if someone is like, you know what, it's just not for me, like, I'd be like, okay, that's cool. Like, I can understand it's not for everybody. Like, that's totally fine. But it's when people are like, I detest this. When they get so fucking eloquent and is like, I would rather do this than listen to your band and do this, that, the next thing. I'm like, I feel like I'm like, there's so much more baggage here than just
you know? Their problem.
Yeah.
Their issue, not your issue. It's their issue.
That's just how that kind of those kind of reviews come off to me, and it is just like, as someone, it always seems a bit unhinged, and I think that's why I find it so funny, because I'm like, if someone's like, it was boring, or like, I don't know, I don't really like it that much.
See, I grew up reading Kerrang, so I felt like that was like the best. So I hate everybody else. Like, I can still read like those guys when they review stuff, but I've never liked American writers and reviewers. I just think they suck compared to the Kerrang guys. Got it done right, and they still are largely so, I feel. So.
Yeah.
Like, even things like, you know, Pitchfork and stuff like that, like, it's good for like, I like to, well, not so much Pitchfork anymore, but like,
well, a lot of the Pitchfork guys went to Cream, so Cream is like the new Pitchfork. Like, this dipshit Zachary, he's a Pitchfork guy. That's why I fucking hate him. So
I won't name names. This dipshit Zachary.
Oh, what the hell?
And for a penny and for a pound. It's cool. I think, you know. So, to me, I just usually read reviews just so I kind of know what's in the zeitgeist. Like, even if I don't even read the review, the fact that an album merits a review at the very least,
yeah,
that's usually an indication of like, oh yeah, maybe I should, you know, give this a listen. You know, that's usually
looking through reviews, I automatically go to the one that's like one star or two stars. It's like, what is so fucking wrong with this?
Yeah,
it's so bad about it. And I listen to that first,
yeah,
because it's like, okay, so you know, you've got like fucking 12 albums here that are all like 4 and 5 stars, but you've got 2 albums that are fucking 1 star. And actually, you know, it's like, okay, so if I listen to the 2 albums that have got 1 star and I actually like them, then, you know, where am I going to sit with the ones that are all fucking 5 stars? Are your tastes aligned with mine? I don't know. But I do find that far more fascinating. Like, what warrants 1-star review? I mean, it's like, is it really that shit?
I love doing that for everything, though, even like really mundane, like, you know, if I need to buy a new I don't know, toilet brush, and I'm looking, I'm about to order it online, and I see, oh, this toilet brush has 3,000 reviews and it's got an average of 4.5 stars. Well, that's pretty good. Why is it not 5 stars? You know, someone is clearly very dissatisfied with this otherwise inoffensive toilet brush.
Everything gets a rating.
So yeah,
Everything gets a rating. I got an email the other day that they wanted me to rate the bag of gravel that I bought.
Yes, definitely.
I'm like, what am I going to say about a fucking bag of gravel? Give me a break.
It was rocked.
Yeah,
it rocked. That's
the bag didn't break. The bag didn't.
I get that from like when I buy stuff at Screwfix. It's like, rate these batteries. Well, they fucking worked.
Write one time. I felt I needed to because I bought a pair of earbuds, and suddenly they started just shrieking in my ear. Like they almost made me deaf. Just all of a sudden, there was just loud, and I. So I felt that I should warn people, you could go deaf from these. So that's, they got a little work to do. I didn't put these in to go deaf, you know.
I think that's fair. I think that's fair. That's
like, it's scary. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think my favorite ones I ever came across was, I was buying a comic once. It was, it was a Batman comic by a fairly well-received Batman. You know, it was a Grant Morrison one. So it was like, you know, really, really good. And I found like, oh, why has it only got like 3.5 stars on average? And I scrolled down to all of like the 1-star reviews, and we were like, it was in German. It's like, it's basically all these really disgruntled people giving this book a 1-star review because they ordered it in the wrong language. Dumb, man.
That reminds me of Eric from Raised by Swans, or he is Raised by Swans, but he, I remember him telling me years ago when we were, I think we were away on a tour together, and he said that one of his albums, the last track, this fucking fan had bought this album and was emailed him, was like, this is not right. This record isn't right. It's not fucking sounding right. I want a replacement. So it's like, okay, yeah, sorry. So that CD must have been scratched or something, like whatever. So sent him another CD, and then he gets another fucking email back, and it's like, no, this is fucked as well. Like, maybe something's gone wrong at the factory. And it's like, can you describe like what it is you're hearing that's fucked? And what he was describing was, at the end of the album, he just unplugs his guitar and it fucking makes a noise and it shuts off. And it's like, it's meant to be there. It's meant to be there. And this guy thought that, you know, the whole thing. It was like, you're right at the end of the fucking album.
Yeah.
That's the last thing that happens. That bullshit on that.
Well, thank you guys. Thank you guys for doing this. It was great.
Oh, thank you guys. It's been awesome.
Thanks for having us. Yeah.
Really cool hanging great. Out. Thank you.
It was awesome.
I hope your weather gets better.
Yeah.
I hope ours gets better too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I hope yours gets better. I mean, I think it seems more likely that it will. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, like, it's nice to hope here.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Falling on deaf ears.
Deaf ears one is Luthero chasing euphoria.
There are a lot of popular acts out there, from In This Moment to Infected Rain to Ginger, that have a heavy rock styling with vocals that slide in and out of melodic to aggressive. But what makes them all different is the style of the music that runs underneath. The Canadian five-piece Lutharo has a technically solid melodic heavy metal core, creating quite a strong backbone with very few industrial distractions. These guys are cut from the mold of Shadows Fall. Chasing Euphoria is their second full length, and like the cover art suggests, your synapses should prepare to fire into electrifying high-octane metal. The 11-track run mostly in the 4 to 5 minute range, with two exceptions. The last track, Freedom of the Night, is a burner with a runtime just under 7 minutes. The first track is the only other exception, an instrumental mood setter that bookends nicely by also appearing in the closing seconds of the last track. Suddenly, it's a dark and stormy night with swelling cellos and James Bond movie opening sequence soundtrack feel. It creates a slightly ominous yet dramatic mood. Then, the Reaper's Call spews out next, with the metallic drums of Corey Hoffing tapping and quickly accelerating to warp cruising speed as a throaty scream erupts. There is no looking back now. The raven-haired ball of fury that is Krista Shippenbottom alternates her vocals from a raptor tonsil-bleeding bark to showing us her songbird softer side and back again for the verses, a la Shaky Sue of the Hellfreaks.
I heard that when they brought her in as singer, it was they were casually talking backstage, and they said, if it doesn't work out, we can always ship her bottom back. The lyrical hooks really come out in Time to Rise and Born to Ride, with the vocals and guitar mirroring each other in softer segments, crooning melodies off each other. The return of the roar is always a few bars away that slams you in the breastbone with a satiating fury. There's a wild rolling drum breakout in this track by Hoffing? Yeah. The return of the roar is always a few bars away that slams you in the breastbone with a satiating fury. There's a wild rolling drum breakout in this track by Hoffing, as well as guitar harmonies of Victor Hooker and John Raposo that bring to mind fellow Canadians Traveler and their epic riffage. Shippenbottom is full of venom as she sings, "There is more to what you see, unravel me. It is easy to stay quiet, but they will never silence me." The drums are downright infectious, headbanging, and Hoffing has some stunning drop-the-stick moments. Creating a King opens with a forbidding tolling bell, and there's luscious melodic guitar harmonies right out of the gate. Shippenbottom screams sound like she's being burned at the stake. Well, okay, maybe that was influenced by the song's music video, but at any standards, still chill bump-inducing.
And the guitar chuggy, Paradise or Parasite, you can really hear the creative oscillating bass tones of Chris Pacey. Shippenbottom reaches new levels of enragement as she seethes beyond facades. We climb. Bridges are burning tonight. Reveal your true design. Chasing Euphoria is a really solid album with not one weak track to be found. They have that big heavy metal sound and a dramatic, charismatic frontwoman who also writes great lyrics. All that adds up to a winning formula. I see they're playing at a venue near us very soon. I think we might have to go and catch these rising stars before they are too big to be standing behind their own merch table.
Okay.
Let's play a song. This is Creating a King.
Face to face, you will reach your grave. And the spirit of the sky now.
Okay, Deaf Ears 2 is the new tarot album, Glimpse of the Dawn. Let me start off by saying, if any of you were concerned with the whereabouts of the Hammond B3 that was used on Genesis's Nursery Crime album, tarot's Dave Harrington George has apparently located it, and he employs it obsessively on this record. All kidding aside, Glimpse of the Dawn is the second full-length album from these Australian rockers, and their first for the acclaimed Cruz del Sur label. It's 40-plus minutes of dreamy harmonized guitars, harmonized vocals, loopy piano, and verses like Crestfallen Lepers, Once Seraphim Shepherds, and Commander of Tooth, Claw, and Beak. So you may want to get out your Ian Anderson autographed codpiece for this. Get it out of storage. Tarot parties unashamedly like it's 1972 on these 8 tracks. They show a real flair for riff crafting and assembling epic tracks that don't require epic song lengths. Plus, their logo looks like Stonehenge, so that's kind of cool, you know.
Quality abounds on this record. For example, the 5-plus minute epic, Leshy's Warning. Great title.
That's a great title.
That moves from a lush acoustic workout to an unhurried heap-style giddy-up, fueled by dramatic harmonies from guitarists Felix Russell and Will Fried, listed here as The Hermit. The organ-bolstered title track is packed with retrofitted charms and excellent harmonized vocals from Fried and bassist Dave Walsh. But the tour de force closing track, Heavyweight's The Crown, which features Tarot pulling out all the stops and lots of Hammond from the superbly named keyboardist Dave Harrington George. The track does several about faces, eventually stepping up to a double-time Sabbathy groove adorned by stunning guitar solos. This one's a real treat. Your quandary is whether to go for the oxblood or the swamp green vinyl. Remember us, your home for all things Tasmanian Prague. All right, let's play a song. This is Glimpse of the Dawn. This is Deaf Ears 3, Transit Method, with Other Void. Great name for a prog-adjacent band. Makes me think of Weather Report or Van der Graaf Generator or something like that. In this case, Transit Method is a four-piece out of Austin, Texas. Other Void is their third full-length that just dropped a couple of months ago on Brutal Panda Records. Their combination of Voivod-style space metal and Russian-form freakouts had me hooked from the very first song. Plus, I was convinced they had to be Canadian.
Naturally.
Mm-hmm. Other Void is 7 songs that sound like epics. Despite their brevity, only 2 tracks exceed the 5-minute mark, and the performances of guitarists Brian Rowley and Matt Lococo, which also lends his cool, clean, and or semi-raspy vocal style into the mix, with tracks like Psychometry and Nightmare Machines. It seems obvious that these aren't booty call lyrics or odes to female anatomy.
Speaking of which, I've heard that the Anaconda don't want none. Sorry. You said booty call. I said all this up ahead of time. All right.
It seems obvious that these aren't booty call lyrics or odes to female anatomy. Rather, colorful and imaginative fare topped with a lot of very interesting guitar work.
These guys play heavy shit. That's all I'm saying. No. Just take a listen to something like Another Wasted Life, which rides a skulking low-end riff decorated with bell-like guitar workouts that go on for over a full minute before the first semi-robotic vocal. Very Voivodian indeed. Lococo, pondering, on board the Odyssey, can it show me one more day? Before taking things to a thrillingly crunchy crescendo decorated with glitchy guitar leads that sound like computers belching. But the one that really shines is the one we're going to play for you now, the nearly 9-minute apocalyptic monster Frostbite, which really finds the band stretching out, exploring all manner of spacey guitar and deaf drumming from Matt's brother, Mike Lococo, which leads to a near thrash speed tempo change around the 3 minute mark that will have you headbanging in your seat in no time. Things cool to a floatish pace around the 5 minute mark, thanks to a seamless transition that eventually returns to the mid pace that opened things up. Lococo wailing, "The sky is falling, the devil is calling, the earth is collapsing, the frost is biting down."
Very cool stuff for fans of any of the aforementioned bands. An excellent entry point for those about the prog metal, as well as hats off to Transit Method for this one. I wonder when they have gigs, what is their actual Transit Method? A van? Somebody's station wagon? Inquiring, maybe a hatchback?
Inquiring minds want to know, yes. Let's play a song. This is Frostbite. We did it. We got it done. Yes. Boy, we talked a lot about Aunt Meg.
Lots about Aunt Meg.
Yeah.
And the lack of service at your local big hardware store chain.
Lock her in a room with Trump for 10 minutes. I'll come out and go, "You're right. I should have got my haircut years ago."
You shouldn't grab him by that. In fact, you should grab him by the cookie. That's my new slogan. This has been the Snaggletooth Rock and Roll Podcast. Special thanks to the gang from Midas Fall for appearing on the show. Snaggletooth theme courtesy of Yang's Kemgren of the Firebombs. Deaf Ears theme by Tim Green of the Fucking Champs. Season 3 artwork courtesy of Casey Angel. You can find him on Instagram at Casey Angel Art. Deaf Ears band include Transit Method, Luthorio, and Parrot. All content 2024, the Snaggletooth Rock and Roll Podcast.
You see, the anaconda don't want none unless it's...
I got buns, hun.
This is the Snaggletooth Rock and Roll Podcast.